Hello, party people. This is Michael Lamberti with the new game of the day. This one is Unzeka against Paderewski, played in Tel Aviv in 64 during the chess Olympiad. And Unzeka was a very great German player in the 60s, but he's more known for his losses against very strong opponents. You find those losses in the chess books, you know. He lost the instructive games against Karpov in the Ruy Lopez. He lost against Tal, I guess, also in the Ruy Lopez. So he lost against a lot of people, and every time he lost those games, basically he got mentioned in the books. So I decided, okay, let's look at the game that he actually won with the Ruy Lopez, and this is a very instructive game. Okay, let's start. We see the Murphy defense here. Okay, no line. Okay, with c2 to c3. Basically, white allows the Marshall gambit, d7 to d5, which I would never allow with white. Unless you're the expert, which you're not, so don't play c3, but a4 instead. Okay, but black did not go for the Marshall gambit. Okay, this is a strange looking move, but an old idea. Basically, black wants to put his knight on d7, his bishop on b7, and then going for c4. And yeah, basically putting his pieces on good squares, and hoping for the best. This is a playable, of course, playable move. Is it's one of the standard variations in the Ruy Lopez. Okay. Black goes with his plan, and white plays a knight to d2, which is the standard plan in white Ruy Lopez. Of all plans, he wants to put this this bishop on f1 and then e3 or g3 with the aim to somehow land on f5. This is really the standard move and the standard idea in the Ruy Lopez. You see this in every, basically in every game, this idea. And as you can see now here, the knight landed on g3. Black kicks the bishop away on c2. And okay, black plays g6 to avoid a bishop landing on, knight landing on f5. But he, of course, weakens his structure. Now you have like these weak squares around the king. But okay, it's not easy playing the Ruy Lopez. And white immediately exploits this. Black here exchanges his black bishop. But okay, white pounces on this liability here, this hole on h6. And black, says, okay, no square for you, and basically cuts the queen from coming to h6. And here, white plays d4. This is a good move here. Basically, you're controlling the center. You're preparing all kinds of move. And yeah, at the end of the day, what you want is you want to attack with those pieces the black king. In this situation, in this structures in the Ruy Lopez, white basically goes for an king's attack, and nothing else matters. He wants to attack the king, and before he does, he wants to gain the center, so that the center is secure before you start any operations on the king side. Black rightfully did not take, because if you open the position, then you're just playing into white's hand. And okay, white just centralizes. He is not in the hurry, and the position is a little bit better for white. White has better structure and his king is safer. Okay, now in this position, as I said, white tries to attack, attack, attack. So he has to find good squares for his pieces. He has to open the position, and he has to bring his pieces closer to the black queen. And this is what he does. He prepares to go with the bishop, pardon, with the knight to g4. He prepares f4, opening up lines to the king. And yeah, at the end of the day, he still has his strong bishop. This bishop, this white bishop of blacks, is rather weak. And okay, this is a standard move, king to e7, and another standard move. White opens up the position. Again, he wants to open lines against black's king, and the only chance that black here has is to somehow keep the position closed. If he can keep the position closed, then he has a chance. Otherwise, he will lose. Okay, plays c5 to somehow counterattack on the queen side. White goes back with his knight to f3, controlling some squares on the in the center. And now black took. And okay, this is not a good move at all. As I said, if you're not if your position is not good, you should not open up the position, and this is exactly what he did. Okay, his aim would have been to or should have been to close to the position, but now he opened it up, and now white pieces find beautiful squares, and basically with this exchange, black activated white pieces. And okay, yeah, yeah, the bishop is back in the game. Bishop b3, eyeing this diagonal. And if ever a piece comes on f7, you would have an automatically attack against f7. Why black here prepares with rook to c7 to double up his rooks on the c line, and also he tries to overprotect f7 in the case that this knight moves. Then he would have two pieces protecting f7. Okay, black goes, white goes out of the way of any checks here on c5. He plays h1, king h1. You don't have to rush this positions. Okay, now he now white played rook to e2. He wants to be prepared if the rooks come over to double up on the c line. And again, he plays it very slowly. Okay, this is a very bad move. Again, as I said, you don't open up this kind of positions. And okay, white immediately strikes in the center. And now basically all of white's pieces get even more active. And okay, this is another bad move. Last chance, he wants to play the knight to d5. Okay, this is a serious blunder, because again, as I said, the last moves, it was all about activation, and now it's like a combination point. This is like the ultimate activation move. You basically open up every line against the king and the queen. So this has to be extremely bad for black. And okay, now look at the position. Black has all the pieces in the attack. Everything is out in the open. White is controlling the center, and black has no counterplay at all. Okay, this is extremely hard to defend. And last three moves of black were very weak. This is like the point. If most people are not able to defend well, okay, if you can defend better than your peers, you will always be a bit better. Okay, most people cannot defend. Most people cannot somehow come up with a tedious hard defense, and you see it here now. White's pieces, look at it, you have like here this Aliekin gun, now this, all the heavy figures here, all the heavy figure pieces here, concentrated. And basically black is just giving up his two pieces, this to knight so that he can move at all, because otherwise he would be cramped in like nothing. But again, this is hopeless. Okay, this is meaningless. Okay, black has no good moves. And okay, I mean, here we had seen a lot of exchanges, and you could say, okay, exchange, and now black has more room, and yeah, his king is not that safe. But okay, after this move, this is a very, very strong knight. Okay, this knight controls basically the whole board, and is worth a whole rook. He threatens this fork that would immediately kill. He has all these squares that he controls, and the rook has basically no squares, and you can't even exchange sacrifice, because then white would just be a piece up. Okay, black tries to go for a perpetual, tries to somehow harass the black the white king. And here white finished off the game with this move, and there's nothing that black can do. He can only give his queen and immediately lose. But okay, let's see what would happen if he would try something like this. Then you have your mate. And okay, what else could he try? Let's say king to g7. Then you have a mate in 5 moves. So this knight here basically killed black. Okay, let's look at the variations. This is very instructive. And okay, this is mate. Okay, I mean, the lessons from this game is if you have a bad position, never open up the position. And if you have an open position, try to open it even up more, as we said and saw in the last game. Try to activate your pieces, even if you have to sacrifice. Try to open up the position more. Try to cramp your opponent even more in. And I think it's very funny that even after this sequences, where basically white is giving back a material and he gives black room to move, that black is still hopeless. You can see how good white position was, and it didn't even had to play all the best moves. I mean, here in this position, knight to e4 would have been the strongest move, and now black wants, or the engine wants, g5. Okay, let's look at this one. Rook takes, the bishop takes, and okay, what is it that black can do? At the end of the day, these two pieces will always be better than this rook. And his king will be much more vulnerable than white's king, because at the end of the day, black has only this one piece to attack, and white has 3 pieces. So this is clearly better. And again, most human cannot defend this kind of position very good. Okay, what would Jin play? Let's see. We have f6. Okay, nobody would do an exchange sacrifice. Okay, let's play something like this. Okay, this is not working. How do you protect from f6? Okay, this is not working. Okay, so this is basically, okay, you want to avoid bishop to f6, so you basically have to give up your rook. Okay, let's wait a minute, is there something? Can I play bishop to b3? No, let's okay, just take it. And it seems that black has no perpetual. I mean, if he has no perpetual, then he will lose. Okay, thank you very much. Bye bye.